because he's already given me stuff as far as where we'll go next week along the lines of this. And every message is connected. Do you know there's really only one message? Did you guys know that? When I got that revelation, and I'm still getting that revelation, you know, Christianity is full of paradoxes. You know that. You're saved, but you're being saved, which is true, both. If you're born again, you're saved, you're born again, but you're being saved if you're renewing your mind and you're growing. But, I'm getting these things, and the Lord showed me that there's basically only one message, Jesus Christ and Him crucified. In other words, all that He accomplished in His death, burial, and resurrection, and what's available to you and I as believers. But within that one message is multitudes, just unending messages, so you never run out. You never run out. There's so many things that, I mean, I'm just, there's, it's all good. Because it's just, it, God is just so amazing. He's packed. Amen. And He lives in me. And as long, that's why we're exalting the Word. You have to exalt the Word. The Bible, the written Word, but Jesus, the living Word. In fact, all legalism is basically, is just separating Jesus, what He did, the living Word, from the written Word. So if you take Jesus out and what He did, then all you have is a bunch of rules you have to keep instead of His very life that keeps you. The Bible says in Colossians 3 that Christ is our life. Amen? Come on, amen. All right. So many things. But this is, in, so what my point is, what we don't finish on this outline will be rolled into the next outline somehow. So God will make a way. So I'm not that way. I don't feel like I'm pushed to get all this in because it's packed. That's a really, really good problem. It's actually not a problem. It's a blessing. But if you look at the title, it says Seven Keys to a Long Blessed Life. Seven Keys to a Long Blessed Life. Now, there are more keys, but this I've just picked seven. And I want to say this to you. First of all, just living long is not necessarily a blessing. Living a long blessed life is a blessing. In fact, let me show you. We'll just start with Psalm 1:1 from the Amplified. And I'm not going to go down Psalm 1 today, but I just want to show you. I love how the Amplified Bible brings this out when it describes blessing. Psalm 1:1 from the Amplified. Blessed. I love this. Happy. How many know it's good to be happy? How many know it's better to be happy than it is sad? How many know there's a lot of believers that aren't happy? Okay. Happy, fortunate, prosperous, and enviable is the man who walks and lives not in the counsel of the ungodly, following their advice, their plans, and purposes, nor stands submissive and inactive. Boy, we could camp on all these. In the path where sinners walk, nor sits down to relax and rest, where the scornful and the mockers and the criticizers gather. And it says, but his delight is in God's word. That's why we have to exalt the word of God. But I love the way it says this, blessed, happy, enviable, to be envied, prosperous. These are all the things that constitute being blessed. Blessing is more than just physical needs. That's just one facet of it. Blessing is relational. Blessing is having peace in your heart. Blessing, it's all encompassed in God's blessing. And that's all available to us. Let me say this. God's blessing is not dependent upon how things are going in this world. How many know the world, if you watch the news, the world's a mess. Nobody can get along with anybody about anything. It's a mess. You know why? Because man needs Jesus. And without Jesus, he's going to consistently be a mess. Amen. All right. So God, number one, if you look in your outline, it says intro, God's will. Go to Psalm 91, verses 14 through 16. Psalm 91, verses 14 through 16. We'll just do the out. Because he, you and I, have set our... God, first of all, let me say this. God set his love upon us, correct? Amen. But you know it's up to you and I to set our love upon him. Amen. Amen? You know, you can decide where your heart goes. Did you know that? In Matthew chapter 6, it says, where your treasure is, there's your heart. I used to think that my heart was just... I couldn't help it. My heart just went whatever I like, that's where my heart went. But actually, what I value and what I treasure, that's where my heart goes. And that's how we set our love upon him. Say, I set my love upon him. Blessed is he that has set his love upon me. There's a blessing in that. Once again, I quoted it earlier. But if any man love God, the same is known of God. 1 Corinthians 8:3. In other words, when you choose to respond to God's love for you, we love because he first loved us. There's a blessing on that. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? I think that that's simple, but it's very, very awesome, very profound. Therefore, will I deliver him? You know, God has promised to deliver you. That means what you're going through, there's a promise of being delivered from what you're going through. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. You know, things come, but they come to pass. But there's a promise, but you have to claim it. You have to say, that's mine. I'm taking that. I'm not going to let go. I will set him on high because he hath known my name. I will set him on next verse. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble and I will deliver him and honor him. That's awesome. Notice it doesn't say you won't have troubles. A lot of people get confused because they think, man, I'm going God's way. Why is it? Listen, if you're going God's way, the enemy wants to stop you. There is a devil. I'm sorry to have to inform you. Some people are teaching there is no devil, that the devil's just in your mind. It's just carnal thinking. It's amazing. How do you cast that into pigs? How does unrenewed mind, how does your unrenewed mind or your unrenewed thinking go about as a roaring lion? Give me a break. Give me a break. We need to believe the Bible. So many people are believing what people say about the Bible rather than believing the Bible. That's the essence of man's religion. You need a relationship with God. That's what we're trying to point you to. With long life, they say this is a promise. With long life will I satisfy him. With long life will I satisfy him. With long life, God has promised to satisfy you. But notice it's contingent upon you setting your love upon him. You looking to him. You seeking first his kingdom and his righteousness. It says, with long life will I satisfy him and show him, look at this, show him my salvation. And his salvation is Jesus. Now jump over to Psalm 92, verse 12. Next chapter. Next chapter, Psalm 92 and verse 12. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. Now think about the palm tree. You ever thought about it? You ever seen a hurricane? You ever watched the news or anything and seen a hurricane and those palm trees are like this?
Yeah.
They're bent all the way down like this and then they come back up.
Yeah.
They can take a lot, right? That's. I think it's interesting he doesn't say like a maple tree.
Yeah.
Or like an ash tree. Ash borer would have got that one. Notice he doesn't say that. They would just snap right off, but not a palm tree. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar, strength in Lebanon. Next verse. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord. Those that visit the house of the Lord. Those that are once in a while. Oh, bless God, Chris, we're the house of the Lord. Well, so's the church.
Amen.
Those that be planted in the house of the Lord. You know there's no lone rangers in the body of Christ? You know we need each other?
Yes.
And some people don't want to say it. Bless God, I'm just as good as you. You may be better than me. It's not the point. It's saying we need each other. We need the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. We need those things. You notice when we have the gifts of the Spirit, it isn't the Chris show? Or the Matt show? Or the Misty show? Or any show? It's about Jesus.
Amen.
That's what we want. We want him to be exalted.
Yeah.
I don't want you leaving here looking, isn't he something? I have never seen such big biceps. That's why I keep them covered. No, I'm kidding. Check them pipes out. No, I'm just kidding. See, people don't understand. You have to stay planted. Yeah, last night I was laying there, I believe the Lord quickened the parable of the sower to me. And you know, the parable of the sower is amazing. No matter how long you're in it, you always get something. Have you ever noticed, have anybody ever noticed that? Rich and I were talking about that recently. But I was just pondering the parable of the sower, and I thought, you know, what tests everyone is time. Every seed is tested by time. Those sown on the rocky ground, they immediately spring up. Immediately the enemy steals that because there's no understanding in their heart. Those that are sown on shallow ground, they spring up. They have no root in themselves, you know, and they're offended when tribulation and persecution arises for the word's sake. And then those that are sown among the thorns, you know, eventually they grow up with the thorns and the thorn chokes them out, the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches and lust of other things. But here's the point. All of them that did not bring forth fruit, and even the one that did on the good heart, the element that was being overcome was time. You know why tribulation and persecution comes? It comes in this fallen world to try to convince you that God is not who he said he is, and that the promises don't work, and that God is not good. That's why the parable of the sower is so imperative that you understand. Listen, you can't lose unless you quit. Though people don't drown for falling in the water. They drown when they don't get out. Amen. If you get up, you can't lose. A just man falls seven times and he gets up again is what it says in Proverbs. What's that saying? He just keeps getting up. He just doesn't quit. He has resolve. Quitting is a permanent solution to a temporary problem. And I'm speaking to somebody. You can't lose if you don't quit. You just keep going. You just keep going. That's what, I know I talk about praying in the Holy Ghost a lot and get used to it because I don't change in that area. I just get worse. And you know why? Because it does something to me. I mean, I'll pray and there's so many times I'm praying and I'm not feeling a thing and I'm just, all that stuff's going on and I don't pray and all this, and the Kyle, you're not praying as much as you should and the devil try, all that lies try to come at you. And all of a sudden, I just noticed I am just full of fire all the time. That's the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
That's not me. I can't maintain that. Especially the more you go through life and you have negative things come at you, you can't maintain the fire of God in your own strength. It's impossible.
Amen.
But you can with Holy Ghost fire.
Amen.
Amen. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord, they'll flourish in the courts of our God. Next verse. They shall bring forth fruit in old age. They shall bring forth fruit in old age. They shall. One of the lies of the enemies is to get you to think, well, life's just passed you by. It's been too long. You haven't fulfilled. Listen, that's a lie. Moses under the law was 80, and that's when he was getting started. We need to think different, guys. This is about God. I was sitting there thinking, this is not about this earthen vessel. It's about who's in this earthen vessel. Those that be still bring forth fruit in old age, if those that are planted in the house of the Lord, they shall be fat. Who wants to be fat? It's a joke. I heard one amen. Go to Amplified Bible. Go to Amplified Bible. Look at that. Go to the Amplified Bible. Growing in grace. Growing in grace. Growing in grace. Not staying the same in grace. You know how I can tell people aren't staying the same in grace? If you're not being activated in what God's called you to do, you're not growing in grace. Growing in grace, they shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They'll be full of sap, of spiritual vitality. They'll be rich in verdure, of trust, love, and contentment. They'll be rich in these things. They'll be rich in these things. Next verse. They are living memorials to show that the Lord is upright and faithful to his promises. He is my rock and there is no unrighteousness in him. Glory to God. Look at your outline. God's will is that we live a long, blessed life. And we've talked about this before. There's three things to check off before you check out. You remember what they were? Number one, are you born again? Number two, have you fulfilled what God has purposed for you or called you to do? And number three, are you satisfied? You know, God wants us to be satisfied. Amen. Paul, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, I believe, and I've heard this said, and I believe it's true, that Paul chose martyrdom when his course was finished. Isn't that something? Are we on, Mark? Sound like I changed. All right, I think. Okay, so God's will is for you and I to live a long, blessed life. And I've already mentioned this. A blessed life is not exempt from problems. In other words, there will be things to try to stop that. But if you will side with God's word, if you will plant God's word in your heart, if you'll go God's way, you will or you are promised a long, blessed life. And you know why we want to live long on this earth? Anybody know why? Because we're afraid of dying? No, we'll cover that. No, we want to live long on this earth because we want to fulfill everything God has put for us to do. God wants to do something through you. All right, here it is. Number one, key number one. You're blank. I know grace people don't like this because they don't think it's grace, but it is. Here it is. Number one, obedience and grace. Obedience and grace. Go to Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12, King James. That you be not slothful. We talked about that last week. But followers of them who through faith, Faith, inherit the promises. No, faith and patience or long-suffering inherit the promises. Don't you like the English word long-suffering? Think about long. Sorry, I'm not trying to. You know, I would love to get up here every week and do what I call cotton candy Christianity. Ah, God loves you. God loves you. God loves you. Have a great day. Have a great day. God loves you. It's sunny outside. You're never going to have any problems if you're in God's will. But I would be lying to you. You know why I call it cotton candy Christianity? Because it's like cotton candy. You put it in your mouth. It dissolves instantly. You get a little sugar buzz, but there's no sustenance. You can't live on cotton candy. Anybody trying it? No. You can't. All right. So obedience and grace. James chapter 4, verse 7. James chapter 4 and verse 7. I call it long-haul obedience. Long-haul obedience. Faith and patience. Hebrews 6, 12. I love this definition of patience. What is patience? It's faith over a prolonged period of time. Faith over a prolonged period of time is patience. Faith over a prolonged period of time is patience. That's why it says through faith and patience, Hebrews 6, 12. But James 4, 7, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. The word resist means to actively fight against. But notice it says submit to God. What does that mean? I'm the kind of guy, I want to know what that means. Look over here. What does submitting to God look like? Here it is. Submission to His Word. Submission to His Word. Amen? Isn't that simple? But how many people want God's individual Word, but they don't, they're rejecting His written Word? Amen? Do you know there's God's specific Word, and then there's God's, what I call, identity leading? In other words, I'll use the example of you. When your kids are little, you know, you tell them pretty much everything to do. But some people are like that, or I shouldn't say that. Hopefully, in the natural, people aren't like that when they're a grown man or woman. And they're, Mom, hello, this is Chris, yes. I want to know, is it okay if I unplug the toaster? Go ahead, you sure? Okay, now on my way to the toaster, the trash is pretty full. Should I take that out? You don't want that, right? You want to be led. You hope that you're mature enough to be led. I call it identity leading. Hopefully when you're mature enough in the Lord, you don't have to pray about you don't have to have an individual leading, that's what I should say, about every individual thing. There's what I call an identity leading. You're just led out of who you are. Should I be nice to this person? What does the Word say? I don't even know, but I'm going to be mean. No, you're led out of who you are. And then there's specific, I'll give you another example. People say this all the time. Well, just pray and ask God what He would have you to give. You know, the Bible said there's a higher form of leading. I'm not saying that's totally wrong, but I'm just saying in 2 Corinthians 9, 7, it says, as every man purposes in his heart, so let him give. You know, you can purpose in your heart. See, well, that's not spiritual. Yes, it is. It's biblical. But see, we get sometimes we get so mystical. God, everything, God, what should I do this? God, what should I do that? Hopefully I'm in a relationship enough with God that I can be led on some things that I want to use the word common sense. Things that are just in line with the Word. Yes, there's specific leadings too, like who should I marry, who should, all those kind of things. God will show you. But I'll give you another example. Who should I marry? If they don't love the Lord, you don't even need to pray about it. Because the Word says not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Amen. Well, I'm going to change them. That's called missionary dating, and it rarely, if ever, works. All right, moving right along. So what does submitting to God look like? It means submission to His Word. Look at from the Amplified, 2 Corinthians 3:18. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. All of us, as with unveiled face, because we continue to behold in the Word of God, we continue to behold, I love this in the Amplified, in the Word of God as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord. You know, the Bible says Christ in us is the hope of glory. Colossians 1:27. But say we behold in the Word of God as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are constantly being transfigured, metamorphosed into His very own image in ever increasing splendor from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Amen. So submitting to God is submission to His Word. One more. In King James, Proverbs chapter 13, verse 13. Proverbs 13 and verse 13. Whosoever despises, I'm going to go from the King James if you don't mind. That's awfully good there too. Whoso despises the word shall be destroyed. Now that's amazing. The word despises, the word shall be. Now this is a promise, guys. This is a promise. I was talking to a gentleman this morning, and he was telling me, he lives in another city, but he was telling me how so many Christians don't even, it's like the word's not even a factor in their decisions. Have you seen it? Have you seen it? It's like we're doing everything just like the world. But the Bible says, whosoever despises the word shall be destroyed. You know what despises means in the Hebrew? It means to regard as insignificant. Wow! Does that jerk your chain? It does mine. Look at this. But he that fears or reverences the commandment, the word of God, shall be rewarded. That's good news right there. Amen. Hey, I see these verses and they just blow my mind. Here's another one in Proverbs. Look at Proverbs 10:24. Proverbs 10:24. Look at this one. The fear of the wicked. Well, that's not me. I'm not a Hitler. Well, we'll see this in a minute. The fear of the wicked, it shall come upon him. But the desire of the righteous shall be granted. I said, Lord, what's the wicked? How does God see the wicked? Psalm 10:4. Watch this. Watch this. See, God puts these things in there for our benefit. It's like I'm going to give you the answer. I'm going to help you. Here's the answer. Just go this way. This isn't about being perfect. It's about putting faith in the one who's in us who is perfect. You're perfected in Him. It's about keeping your faith in Jesus. Look at this. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, his outward show, will not seek after God. God isn't even in his thoughts. That's what God sees wicked as. Whatever form the outward manifestation is, that's a whole other animal. But man, if God's not even in my thinking, what's wrong with my heart? It doesn't mean I'm not born again, but God sees that as wicked. I love this because it tells me I can keep God. See, God will keep me in perfect peace if my mind is stayed upon Him because I trust in Him. God promises to keep me in perfect peace.
That's right.
You know, we all get attacked with fears. But you know, you can cast them on the Lord. You can say, Lord, I can't handle this. He goes, I know. Here, give it here. Hand it over to Him. What if it comes back? Hand it over. Speak. I say, I've cast this on the Lord. It's not mine. God has promised He'll handle it. I'm not going to worry about it. You know, how many know we live in a world that's broke? Lawnmower leaks oil. Roof leaks. This ain't going right. That ain't going right. Toilet's broke. Whatever. You know, that's the world we live in. Cars doing this or that. I mean, that's the world we live in. But you know, you can have peace in the midst of all that. Do you know that? You can cast your care upon the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And you know what? God will take care of it. When you cast your care upon the Lord, not only do you have peace of heart and mind, God will take care of it. God will get it, fix it. God will have somehow, some way it'll work out. Isn't that awesome? You know, most of the things we worry about don't mean nothing. Do you know 100 years from now, I remember that May Day and I was so worried about that. What was it anymore? You won't even remember it. Amen. All right. Submission to the word. All right. Obedience, hearing and responding. The written word. The written word, hearing and responding. Let's go. I love this example. And the Rhema word. I got them there together. I want you to show you this example. 1 Samuel chapter 23, verse 15. I love this example. Love it, love it, love it, love it. How many know that just because you get a word from God doesn't mean it's automatically going to be fulfilled? Just because you get a word from the Word doesn't mean it's going to be fulfilled without your cooperation. We started a Caris series called How to Find, Follow, and Fulfill God's Will. Do you know you were born with purpose? Do you know you have purpose? But let me tell you something else that'll rock your world. It's not going to happen automatically. You're going to have to cooperate. I'm going to throw this at you. You're going to have to fight the good fight of faith because there's an enemy that does not want you to fulfill your purpose. There's more to life than just eating, going to work, getting home, watching a little TV, eating again, and going to bed and doing it all over. There's more to life than that. God has purpose for every single one of us. We got to believe that. And God's purpose for you is way better, way greater than your purpose for yourself. Anybody hearing this? This is awesome. God has so much more for you. That's why it says, when Paul prayed in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20, he said, it says, now unto him, after you get this love revelation of him, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to this power that's working in us. God is able. When the power's working in you, God's able to do even beyond what you can even ask or think. That's our God. God wants us to start dreaming again. God wants us to take the limits off him. God wants us to see ourselves in the blessing. God wants us to see ourselves with his favor on us. People, come to me because Christ is in me, the hope of glory. That's what God wants. But somebody's saying, oh yeah, that's great for this person. That's great for you, Chris. But that, no, it's for all of us. You're somebody's answer waiting to happen. But if you don't know it, and if you think, no, I'm just... Stop looking at you and start looking at who's in you. Amen. That's what we need to be looking at. That's not bragging on yourself. That's bragging on him. I call it biblical bragging. I am one bragger. I'm always bragging on Jesus in me. I told my wife, I told her last night, she was sitting and I said, she was sitting on the great white throne. And I was telling her. So I had to throw that in. And I told her, I said, listen, this thing in me is way bigger than me. Carol just got it. I did that because I knew it would get a laugh. I will be honest. But listen, I told her, I said, this thing is bigger than me. Are you hearing me? This is for you, not just me. This is for all of us. This calling is so big. I think I was too funny. What?
A little more clean.
Clean it up a little bit, right? All right. We're married, all right? First Samuel, here's my point. Just because you have a word from God, a word from the Word, does not mean it's automatically going to come to pass without your cooperation. Now look at this. Here's an example. 1 Samuel 23, verse 15 through 18. And David saw that Saul, King Saul, who was trying to kill him, was come out to seek his life. You see that? And David was in the wilderness of Ziph in a wood or in the woods. Next verse. And Jonathan, Saul's son, Jonathan loved David. You know the story. Jonathan was in covenant with David. Jonathan was on David's side. And Jonathan, Saul's son, arose and went to David in the woods and strengthened his hand in God. How many know that's good? Next verse. Watch this. And he said unto him, fear not, for the hand of Saul my father shall not find you. And thou shalt be king over Israel. Watch this. And I shall be next unto thee. And that also Saul my father knoweth. Now stop. I believe this was God's desire for Jonathan's life. Thank you. This was God's desire for Jonathan's life. But it did not happen automatically. In fact, it did not happen at all. Here's why. Look at the next verse. Here's why it did not happen. Verse 18. And they two made a covenant before the Lord. And David abode or stayed in the woods. And Jonathan went to his house. Are you hearing that? You know what Jonathan should have said? He should have said that word. They made that covenant. They should have said, listen, I'm staying with you. Amen. How many of you know the safest place to be is in God's perfect will? Amen. You know, so often we think like, no, if I'm in God's will, that doesn't look right. We base it on reason rather than basing it on God's word. Jonathan should have said, listen, I'm going with you. And I'm not going back to my house. It was probably easier for him to go back to his house. How many of you know that the easiest path is not always God's path? That what looks good is not always God's path. Jonathan did everything. He strengthened David's hand. He did all this. But instead of going with David, he went back to his house. The next time you hear of Jonathan is in 1 Samuel chapter 31, where Jonathan loses his life on Mount Gilboa against the Philistines. That's the next time you hear of Jonathan. That was not God's plan for Jonathan's life. How many of us get God's word, we get God's plan, but because it's easier not to go God's way, it's easy to side with that and say, well, God's plan will still come to pass. It might not. In fact, it probably won't. You see, and let me say this to you. I'm not talking about foolishness. I'm not talking about leaving it. But I'm saying begin to take steps toward where God is calling you. Begin to take those steps.
That's right.
You know what I love about God? You know, faith is a walk in the light. It's not a leap in the dark. And what I love about God is it's just one step at a time. Psalm 119, verse 105. Your word, thy word is a light unto my path, a lamp unto my path, and a light unto my feet. In other words, you show me, Lord, one step at a time. But begin to head that way. Begin to head that way.
Amen.
Begin to head that way. Begin to do what's, well, it's not easy, Lord. It's not going to be easy, but God will strengthen you. If you would have told me when I started pastoring that it would be as hard as it was, I'd say, number one, I'd called, probably, I well, maybe not would have called you a liar, but I thought, that person's whacked. It's not that hard. That's what I would have thought. But you know God's been faithful, and God still is faithful, and God doesn't quit. As long as I don't quit. In fact, God wants to do things. I believe there's a breaking. I believe you stick with God and all of a sudden, one day you just don't quit. Because I've prayed so many times, Lord, if there's anything else, I don't pray that anymore. Because I'm done praying that. I'm done praying that. I am. Because, you know, there comes a time when you got to say, Lord, you don't ever give me plan B, so there must not be a plan B. You know, but see, we always want plan B because we like to be secure. We like to have security in our resources. There is no security in this life.
Right.
The safest place to be, like Jonathan. If Jonathan would have went into the woods, yes, it might have not looked good. It might have been safer to go back to his house. All of his servants, all of his bodyguards, all those people would have been there. It would have been safer in the natural, but it ended up being the wrong choice. Amen. Praise God. So obedience is hearing and responding. Amen. Hearing and responding. Go to flip the benefits of His Word. Flip the page. What are we looking at time-wise? Okay, the benefits of His Word manifest as we submit to His Word. The benefits of His Word manifest as we submit to His Word. The benefits of His Word manifest as we submit to His Word. Now watch this. I want to give you an example. I got down there a specific leading, like who I should marry. But I talked to you about specific leading, and then the what you could call just the leading of the Word, or what I call identity leading. Here's an example. Let's go to Colossians 3, verse 15, and then I'll give you the example. Colossians 3, 15 and 16. I'm trying to hurry because I'm going to get one more. We're going to get number two, and then we'll be done. Colossians chapter 3, verse 15, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Now, this is powerful. The word here in the Greek, it means let the peace of God umpire, like an umpire in baseball, calls the situation safe or out. That's exactly what this says, if you look it up in the Greek. To the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful. We brushed by that. Be thankful. Go to the next verse. Watch this. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual song, singing with grace in your heart always, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Now watch this. Here's an example of what I call an identity leading, or a leading from the Word, and an individual leading. There's two questions here. Ready? There's where should I work? That's a specific leading. And then there's the other one, should I work? That's the identity leading. 2 Thessalonians 3:10, if a man don't work, he doesn't eat. So, should I work is settled, right? The Word says I should, okay? Where I work is specific. Can you hear that? Is that a good example? Okay, one more. Go down here, notes. Man's tradition voids the Word of God. Man's tradition voids the Word of God. Because what tradition is, basically, is we do it this way and we don't ever change. This is why success can be very dangerous. You know why? Because a person who's successful, when I say success, I'm talking the world's success, there's a tendency to depend on your success or what worked in the past instead of depend on God. We always need God's leading. All right. Next one. Number two. Here's a big one for a long, blessed life. Key number two. And it's Mother's Day, right? Honor your parents. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. Look at this. This is so simple. But how many people don't do this? I believe even after you're grown up, we still need to honor our parents. But let me say something. That doesn't mean allowing them to control your life. When you get married, you leave and cleave, or if you move out, you're on your own. But you still can honor them. There's a difference. A lot of people don't know the difference. If mama's controlling the household, something's wrong. I'm not talking about your mama. I'm talking about your mama. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Next verse. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. Boy, there's so much we could say here. Isn't it interesting that Paul's quoting from the Old Testament? From the law. Evidently, that standard is correct. Right? See, there's a lot of grace nitwits out there who aren't grace nitwits. They're promoting a false grace that want to throw the Old Testament out. That's wrong. All 66 books are inspired of God, and they all have application to our life. We just apply them differently than they did in the Old Covenant because we're born again. Amen. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. Why? Next verse. That it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest live a long time upon the earth. Do you know if you're not honoring your mom and dad, it's not going to go good with you? My wife and I just had this conversation, and we were talking about an individual, and I'm saying, listen, as long as that person refuses to honor their parents, it's not going good with them. It won't, and they'll cut their life short.
Amen.
They'll cut their life short. These things are in there for our benefit. You open a door to the enemy.
Yeah.
It's not good. God still loves you. But listen, if you're born again, there's something in you that desires to honor your parents. Isn't that powerful? These are simple things, but how many people think these things have no application to us today because we're under grace? Listen, a lot of what people are calling grace is simply rebellion to law. It's not grace at all. Did I say that right?
Yes.
Rebellion to law is not grace at all.
That's right.
Because let me show it to you. Let me show you what Paul said. Two places. 1 Corinthians 15:10. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 10. Well, we'll have to pick up. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God, which is with me. God's grace will motivate you unto good works.
Amen.
And Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. Hallelujah. So much here. I wanted to get to number 3. Titus chapter 2, for the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared unto all men. In other words, it's available to everyone. It teaches us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Any grace that isn't teaching that is not the grace of God.
Amen.
Any grace that's not teaching that is not the grace of God. How much time? Okay. How about this? All right, just a little bit. I'm on just a little bit. I want to do number 3. Here, I'm going to do it quick because I want you to see this. Key number 3, put blank God first.
Amen.
That's simple, right? Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Seek it. That's something you do, but I thought you have it. Yes, you do. Another Christian paradox. You have it, but you keep seeking it. Which is true? Yes.
Amen.
Both. Now watch this. Seek ye first God's kingdom. I'm going to show you a powerful example here. Well, Proverbs 3, 1 and 3, and then we'll go to 1 Kings, and then I'll be done. Proverbs 3, 1 through 3. My son, forget not my law, forget not the word, God's standard, but let your heart keep my commandments. Next verse. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Wow. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of your heart. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3. Remember Solomon's dream? This is an awesome example of putting God first. Watch this. And Solomon loved the Lord. You know, I was listening to Andrew teach, and he was talking about Paul and Silas being in jail and how they were praising God. He goes, and here's a thought. They just loved God. You know, sometimes just loving on God when you have no motive, just love Him. You'll move God because that's what He loves. And Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David his father, only he sacrificed and burnt incense in the high places. Next verse. Watch this. Verse 4. And the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. 1,000 burnt offerings, leave this up here, did Solomon offer upon that altar. Now, I have not taught on the offerings yet, but I'm going to. You know what the burnt offering was? Total dedication to God. You know, it was not a mandatory offering, it was a voluntary offering. Solomon was saying, I'm dedicating my whole being to you, Lord. I'm yours. Now look what it did for him. Go to the next verse. Watch this. Verse 5. And Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, ask what I shall give thee. I want the world. I want everything. Now think about it. Look at the next verse. And Solomon said, thou hast showed unto thy servant David, my father, great mercy according as he walked before thee in truth and in righteousness and uprightness of heart with thee. And thou hast kept for him this great kindness that thou hast given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. Next verse. And now, O Lord my God, thou hast made thy servant king instead of David my father, and I am but a little child. He recognized him in himself. And I know not how to go out or come in. Watch this. And thy servant is in the midst of thy people, which thou hast chosen, a great people that cannot be numbered or counted for multitude. Next verse. Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people. The word understanding means a hearing heart. Give me a hearing heart. That's what it means in the Hebrew. Heart to judge so I can do right for the people. Isn't this amazing? Solomon said, give me a hearing heart so I can be a blessing to the people. Notice that, Lord, give me all this so I can go and do my own thing. You know, God doesn't want us to camp in a cabin in the middle of nowhere and never touch people. He wants us to get involved with people. People are what it's all about.
Amen.
My hope isn't in this life. It's in the next. I got many hopes in this life, but my ultimate hope is the next. Hallelujah. Go therefore, give thy servant a hearing heart, that's what the Hebrew says, to judge thy people that I may discern between good and bad. For who is able to judge this, thy so great a people? Next verse. And the speech pleased the Lord. The speech pleased the Lord. Remember, he started by dedicating his entire being to God. And he said, this speech pleased the Lord, that Solomon had asked this thing. Look what God did. Look at the next verse. And God said unto him, because thou hast asked this thing, and hast not asked for thyself long life, neither hast asked riches for thyself, nor hast asked the life of thine enemies. Many of us would have failed right there. No, I'm kidding. But hast asked for thyself understanding, a hearing heart to discern judgment. Well, watch what God did. This is so good. Behold, I have done according to thy words. Lo, I have given thee a wise and an understanding and a hearing heart, so that there was none like thee before thee, neither after thee shall any arise like unto thee. Pretty awesome. Next verse. And I have also given thee that which you haven't even asked for, exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, because we put God first and God's desire first, which is people. God's in love with people. But if I make it all about me, like it says, if I'm all wrapped up in myself, I make a pretty small package. How can you tell? I'm always offended. Listen, people will offend you. That's called life. And I have also given thee that which thou hast not asked, both riches and honor, so that there shall not be any among the kings like unto thee all thy days. Wow. Next verse. If you walk in my ways to keep my statutes and my commandments, as David did, then I will lengthen your days. Next verse. And Solomon awoke. Behold, it was a dream. Now watch what he did. And he came to Jerusalem and stood before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, God's presence. Notice what he did. He offered up burnt offerings first. Burnt offerings, holy, voluntary offerings, dedicating his life to Jesus, saying, I'm yours. And watch this. And he offered up peace offerings. You know what peace offerings were? It was the only offering that the offerer was able to partake of. By dedicating himself to God, he was not only experiencing all these things that he didn't even ask for, plus the others, he was experiencing God's peace. God's peace. The peace offering was the only offering that the offerer was able to partake of. Isn't that awesome? Solomon awoke, so and he stood before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, God's presence. He offered up burnt offerings. I'm dedicated to you, Lord. And he partook. He offered peace offerings, which said, this one, I'm partaking of the peace of God. And then he made a feast to all of his servants. Everybody around him was blessed. Hallelujah. All because he put God first. When you put God first, he'll take care of your stuff. He'll take it. Listen, rarely do things in this life go the way we think they should go. But you know what I know about God? He's always faithful.
Always.
Even when, oh, how's this and that? God will make a way. I don't know how. But see, we start comparing ourselves. We think we need to be like this or that. You just need to follow Him. You just need to go His way. You need to put Him first. And God guarantees He'll take care of you. The psalmist David said in Psalm 37, verse 25, I've been young and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. The Bible says when you fear and reverence the Lord in Psalm 115, He not only blesses you, but your children.
Yes, that's right.
That's a promise. But it goes by going His way. See, this is where we got to agree with God. We got to stay on His path. Amen. I'm done. There's a few more keys there. We'll pick up on that because we got a lot more to say. Because God is good. Amen?
Amen.
How many of you believe that God loves you?
Amen.
How many believe that He loves you enough to tell you, this is the way. Walk ye in it. Amen. That's why He tells you those things. But if we don't preach grace 102 and we always stay on grace 101, people will never know that and they'll think it doesn't matter how or where I walk. I always say it, if I roll around in the poison ivy patch, God didn't give me poison ivy. I know that's deep. God still loves me, but I'm itchy. Amen. All right. Praise God.